finally my time. And I'm so happy to see the faces of all of you here. Today looks like a pre-COVID service. Looks like it used to be. And I am so impressed and happy to have you here. Now, whenever I stand before this or any congregation, I usually feel an urge to share with everybody anything, any knowledge that I have gleaned, so that you may know also what I know. And if when I try to do that, somebody could say, "Oh, I didn't know that before." You don't have to tell me, but if I help someone to understand something they didn't know before, then I can feel comfortable that my living has not been in vain. You remember times gone by, I tried to, in my prelude, I give a Bible quiz so that you may think of something you were not thinking of before. And for today, my preamble is about the structure of the Seventh-day Adventist movement. This is the preamble, it's not the message of hope. That is yet to come. But all of us here, as individuals and family, comprise what is known as a church, okay? And what's the name of this church? First Springfield Seventh-day Adventist Church. Then churches within a given area comprise what is known as a conference. So we are part of Southern New England Conference, SNEC. We see that many times in the bulletin and elsewhere. Southern New England Conference. And a number of conferences within a given region is called what? A union. A union. And to which union do we belong? Huh? I'm not hearing it clearly. Atlantic Union. Okay. And a number of unions comprise what? A division. Good. Some of you know very well, but some are learning for the first time. It's called a division. And if you observe the back of your quarterlies, every quarter there is a project for a certain division. So the dollars that we give, notice I didn't say cents, dollars, it helps to finance a project in a division. Which division is receiving that help this quarter? All right, some are looking for their quarterlies to get it. It is the Trans-European Division. So we are a part of that. So it would be only reasonable that we give a liberal offering to support the projects. They have only two projects for this quarter. Some divisions sometimes have up to five projects. What are the two projects we have for this quarter? You see it? If you have your quarterly, it's right down here. Okay. Then all hundred divisions put together comprise what? General Conference, GC. Now, we just said that we are in southern New England. So if there is southern New England, then there is also northern New England. What are the states that comprise southern New England? Huh? No? As a matter of fact, there are six states in New England. Did you know that? Okay. What are the three states in southern New England? Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island. And what are the three states in northern New England? Yes, speak up. Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont. Now, five of these states are bound with Massachusetts. There is only one that isn't bounded with Massachusetts. Which is that one? Maine. Very good. And Maine is the largest state in New England. So somebody must have gleaned something today they didn't know before. Okay, now for the message of hope, which is entitled, what? The Already and the Not Yet. Many years ago, or let us pray anyway. Father in heaven, I thank you for this opportunity that I can stand before your people. I want to talk to them about you. But I also want to talk to you about them. So please, let your Holy Spirit abide with each one within these walls today, that their minds may be enlightened, their hopes may be uplifted, and our determination to press onward would be fervent. For we ask it in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Many years ago, there was a general conference session, and one Pastor Charles Bradford was nominated to be the conference, the general conference secretary. But before he was nominated to be secretary, he was an assistant secretary. So he was now moving up from assistant secretary to general secretary. But when you are nominated, there is a right that is usually performed, which is called inauguration. And before he was inaugurated, he had to make an address to the crowd. And he said, "Ladies and gentlemen, I am now standing in the interregnum of the already and the not yet." Why? Because he was already assistant secretary, but he was not yet general secretary because inauguration did not take place. So he said, "The already and the not yet." And many of the attendees, they chuckled, some laughed aloud, because they thought that was a very unique statement. But was it really unique? Is Is he the only one who had an already and a not yet? Far from being. Every one of us have had an already experience, and we also have a not yet experience. Do you understand it? And do you agree with that? Yes. Or the already experience of many of us may have been painful, shameful, regrettable. But that is now in the past. The question is, what are we going to do about our not yet experience? Are we determined to strive to make it better than our already? Our scripture reading taken from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. I would reread what the participant who was up here read just now. 1 John 3, 1, 2 through 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Here John is speaking about the already and the not yet. Already would mean from the beginning of our lives to this present moment. And our not yet would be from the next moment on to the end of our days. And John is saying, already we are the sons of God. Sons and daughters, of course. You may be wondering, am I really a son of God? Or a daughter of God? I still have so many weaknesses and shortcomings and failures. Sometimes I'm envious. Sometimes I'm aggravated. Sometimes I hate a little bit. Sometimes I don't even feel like going to church because of what they said about me or the way they look at me. I'd rather stay home. All these attitudes and behaviors and negativities that we find within ourselves, are we still sons and daughters of God? Who said yes? Raise your hand. I am in agreement with you. Now, when on the night of Jesus' trial, when Peter was identified as one of his disciples, how did Peter react? He cursed and he swore, "I don't know that man." What a shame. After being with him for 3.5 years, was Peter still a son of God? after behaving like that? How do you know he was still a son of God? Jesus had said to him, prior to his denial, Simon, Satan is desirous to have you to be sifted as wheat. But I have prayed for you. And when you are converted, please strengthen the brethren. So Jesus had already prayed for Simon Peter, a son of God, to be victorious over his besetment, over his negative behavior. After he denied Jesus, and Jesus looked on him with a look of pity. You know, if I was in Jesus' place, I would have said, I know that. I told you you were going to deny me. But Jesus did not utter a word. He just looked on Peter with pity. How did it affect him? It pierced him to his very heart. So that he went out from that judgment hall, and some speculator said he went all the way back to Gethsemane. I haven't read that, but I believe it. The same place where Jesus asked him, James and John, to pray with me while I go yonder. But each time Jesus came back to them, what were they doing? Sleeping. But now that Peter's heart was broken, as he felt the self-reproach for denying his Lord, he went out. And what does the scripture say? What was his emotion? He wept bitterly. Didn't just weep. I guess he cried aloud, he boo-hoo, for having denied his Lord. But he was still a son of God. Judas, on the other hand, decided to betray his Lord by pointing him out to the chief priests and rulers, the band that came from the chief priests and rulers. He didn't say much. He just walked up to Jesus and he kissed him. He didn't say a word. But he had told the band, that's a sign. The one that you see me kiss, that's him. Jesus knew his plot. And he questioned Judas. He said, friend, wherefore art thou come? Betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? Remember that before this incident, Jesus had inaugurated the communion service. The bread and wine was given to all of them. Jesus said, drink ye all of it. Eat ye all of it. But what preceded that anyway was that Jesus washed the feet of all 12 apostles. So that included Judas. Judas's feet was washed by Jesus. Judas partook of the emblems of the body and blood of Christ. Was there any hope for him? Why did Jesus do that anyway? He was giving him a very last opportunity to make things right. But Judas did not take advantage of it because he craved the 30 pieces of silver that was the payment or the reward for pointing out Jesus, and he didn't want to lose that. So when Jesus told him in the upper room, "One of you would betray me," then later on Jesus said to him, "That thou doest, do quickly." The scripture says that Judas went out and it was night. But wasn't the Paschal full moon shining that night? Oh, yes, it was. Full and broad in the sky was the Paschal full moon. It was a beautiful moonlight night. Why does it stress the fact? Why does the scripture stress the fact that when Judas went out, it was night? Darkness enshrouded the soul of Judas. So he went out from the company and went on his way. When Jesus was apprehended and he was beaten, he was slapped in his face, he was spat upon, Judas couldn't take it. He said, "No, let me see if I can reverse this transaction. I'll give them back the 30 pieces of silver and see whether they would let him go." So he did give them the silver. They said, he said, "I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood." He thought they would have taken the silver and released Jesus. But what did the chief priests and rulers say? "We have nothing to do with that. You got your pay. You do what you want. We got our mind." And because they did not accept it from him, what did he do with it? He threw it on the floor. The very 30 pieces of silver that he was so obsessed with, for which he denied or betrayed his Lord, he threw the money. He said, "I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood." Now that sounds like a confession. But after a person confessed, the next thing they would do is to become contrite. But instead of becoming contrite, when he threw the money, what does the scripture say he did next? He went out and hanged himself. Up until then, he was still a son of God. He was one of the chosen apostles. And had he repented genuinely, he would have been forgiven. But his heart was so set on his plan, his hidden agenda, that he couldn't face himself or face life or face anyone for what he had done. So he hanged himself. Now, John said, we are now the sons of God. And I mentioned some of our practices that are negative. And he says, John says, that we don't know yet what our not yet gonna be. But one thing we know, that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For for we shall see him as he is. How does that come about? Have you ever read 1 Corinthians 15? Here Paul says, we shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. For the trumpet shall sound, and we shall be raised, and this mortal shall put on what? Immortality. And this corruptible will put on what? Incorruption. Then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Then and only then we will be able to look on the face of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and see him as he is. Today, you and I, we can't look on his glory because we are still untransformed. Even though we have accepted Christ, we walk with him, we pray to him, we talk about him, but yet there is sin in our lives, and for that matter, we cannot see him as he is. John, in the first epistle of his gospel, says that he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. And that's how we know that Peter was a son, because he accepted him. Judas was a son because he accepted and was chosen among the 12. And every one of us whom he has given power to become sons of God because we have accepted him. In spite of our failures, in spite of our shortcomings, in spite of our mistakes, we are sons and daughters of God. And when he comes the second time, and we are transformed from mortal to immortality, and from corruptible to incorruption, then we shall see him as he is, and we shall forever be with him. Now, in the wedding feast that Jesus spoke about in Matthew 22, he says that this king made a feast, and he sent out invitations to invite all who are available to come to the feast. How did they respond when the feast was ready? They made light of it. They even beat the servants who went down to invite them. So much so that the king took his army and he destroyed them. But then he sent his servants where now? To the highways and byways and hedges and compel people to come because his feast is ready. There was a guy who heard the call and he said, oh, well, if the king is hard up for guests, I'll be doing him a favor to show up. So I'm going to go to the feast. And sure enough, he went. You know, he thought he was doing the king a favor. And sometimes people could get the feeling, the impression that coming to church or attending the church, they are doing a favor to the rest of us. And they better treat me right. If they don't greet me as I expect, or even recognize me by saying, we are happy to have you here, Brother John or Sister Mary, I'm not going back. I do them a favor by going and they didn't show any appreciation. Friends, we are not doing a favor to God when we come to worship Him. He doesn't need us. We are the ones who need Him. And we should deem it a privilege to have the opportunity to serve the Lord. So while I'm happy to see all of you, guests or visitors and members, I am happy. But God, you are not doing God a favor. Some people would attend church and even accept offices and be in attendance until somebody crossed their, how we say it, mashed their corns. And I am through with them. That's why sometimes the church is so scant. But I am happy for this partly full congregation today. And I believe heaven is pleased to have you here. So keep coming. Okay. How about the talents we read about in Matthew 25? Where God, the householder, gave talents to his servants. He gave one 5, he gave one 2, and he gave the other 1. And Jesus said that he gave them according to their several ability. You know, we don't all have the same ability. But God knows our ability and our capability, and He deals with us accordingly. So the one who received the 5, what were the talents anyway? Do you know what the talents were? Let us look at it. Matthew 22. My fingers are a little awkward, so I don't get to turn my pages as quickly. Okay. No, I'm sorry, that would be Matthew 25. Matthew 25. I give you that as your homework to find out what the talents were. But the verse I'm looking for says he hid his Lord's money. So the talent or talents were money, cash, he put in their hands. So he gave one 5 pieces of money, the other 2 pieces of money, and the third guy got 1 piece of money. The one who received five, what he did with it? Scripture says he traded, he invested it, and he got five more. The one who got two, he did likewise, and he got four. But the one who received one talent, I guess he was jealous or envious of the other two. Why only one? I am not going to make any attempt. I might lose it if I invest it. So I'm going to bury it, and wherever the householder comes back, he will get his one talent that he had given me. So when the householder returned, and the one who had five got 100% increase, became 10, and the one who had received two made 100% increase or profit, he got four. The one who had received one, what was his response? And he that had received one talent, he said, I know that you're a hard man. You like to reap where you did not even sow. And I was afraid that I would lose the money, therefore I buried it. And there it is. He didn't even have the courtesy to go and bring it. He told the householder, there it is. Meaning, if you want it, go get it. And what was the response to that by the householder? He said, take the very one that he had and give it to those who were profitable. But this unprofitable servant, he is going to be cast out. So whereas recipient number one had five and he was commended, he was told, you have been faithful over a few things, I'll make you ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Recipient number two was given the same commendation. You have been faithful over a few things, I'll make you ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. But the one who had received one and did not invest it, did not appreciate it, he was cast out. My question to all of us is, where do we go from here? Are we determined and prepared to invest whatever the Lord blesses us with? It may be money, it may be ability, it may be efficiency. Whatever blessing we have received from the Lord, what are we prepared to do with it from today onward? You know, the last time I spoke with you, my topic was OTC, meaning overcoming through Christ. And I tried to sing for you a song that was composed by Mahalia Jackson. And she said, we shall overcome someday. And I changed the wording a little bit. And I said, we can overcome today. I don't know how many of us found ourselves overcoming where we had been failing before, but I want to admonish you once again to commit your ways unto the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He will direct your path. and where we have been failing in our already experience, we can be successful in our not yet experience. So let us bow our heads as I approach the throne of grace on behalf of each of us. Father in heaven, once again, I call upon you to thank you for all the folks who have come out to worship today, who have sat and listened attentively. And I believe that your message was understood and digested by each one. And some have made a decision to go all the way with you, so that at your coming, they may hear your commendation, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." There are those who may be careless and indifferent, who would not make any effort to do any better from now on. Lord, we are asking you to deal with each one as you see fit, according to our several abilities. Help those who have not made a wise decision that they will think it over and make a decision that will bring honor and glory to you and salvation to themselves. Bless us all and keep us faithful unto the end. For Jesus' sake, I pray. Amen.